In relation to the title, I just want to say a few things. One was I chose, you know, sleeping with the boss's son as an eye catcher, you know, something that maybe, you know, in terms of PR and all that, gets people's attention. Also to indicate that indeed there were other ways that people, you know, go up in our society, what is called the casting couch phenomena, or marrying the boss's daughter, which is what this was a parody of, all right, sleeping with the boss's son. Because if you think about it, what difference does it make? It has to be the boss, you know. But at any rate, apparently there was a lot of reaction to that in some parts of the community, and I got to thinking about it. And some of the, I guess, negative reaction to the title, in one part, I believe, has to do with what sociologists have observed in recent years about the rise of what they call neo-Puritanism in our society. And, oh, that's inappropriate. That I think some point the reaction, one of the problems in sociology is, unlike the physical sciences, where they are constantly making discoveries, in the social sciences we often make uncoveries. That is, we find out that things aren't the way people would like them to be or the way they ought to be, right? And indeed, for example, sexual manipulation or other things that I'll be speaking about exist out there as ways that people change their social class. So that's what's offensive, is that it actually exists. In other words, it becomes a value conflict. And then I also thought in some instances, perhaps, it was people reading it overall and just saying, wait a minute, everyone I know did it through education or whatever. That too. Sociologists work in terms of generalizations, and that we understand the rule of the exception, all right? That there will be exceptions. I like to think if I can be right 80% of the time, if I can make that level of generalization, if even 70% if I can be right, I wouldn't be here. I'd be in Atlantic City, all right? Because I think I would be very, very wealthy, all right? But at any rate, let me get on with the specifics. And where I want to start is just with defining social class. And I want to do this because in our society, there is a tendency to take what the government says is social class. And the government tends to present us with the idea that class is based solely on economics. They define class by income. And that's all we tend to hear. Now, sociologically, class is seen in a very, very different way, right? That is, we see five interrelated variables. We first see education, the amount of education an individual has. Secondly, we see what we call occupational prestige. Now, not the occupation per se, but how people in our society rank that, how others see. Well, we know that, oh, you're a neurosurgeon. Oh, you shine shoes for a living. Oh, I mean, those are like the quote two extremes. Now, we do indeed then see number three out of the five as income. All right, now, those three usually taken together, by the way, are, if you hear the term socioeconomic status, that's what that usually means. But there are two other variables, and the other two are lifestyle and life chances, all five taken in total. Lifestyle, for instance, has to do do you wear your seatbelt or not? Yeah. Do you smoke? Do you drink? What kind of foods do you eat? How often do you visit a doctor? Yeah. All of these kinds of things make up one's lifestyle. And think about those as also having an effect, for instance, then on your chances in life, how long you're going to live. All right. What will your children do? What are the chances of your children going to college, for instance? And those kinds of things. All right. And I guess I just knocked some of this on the floor. Now, on the other hand, and I made a note here to myself, what we find as we go up the class scale and we look at those variables such as lifestyle and life chances. The chances, for instance, of you being mentally ill go down as you go up the class scale. The chances of you being burglarized, victimized by crime, go down as you go up the class scale. The chances of your life being short go down as you go up the class scale. All right. Now, the research in recent years has been identifying more and more that the key variable appears to be education in those fivefold listing. All right. The most recent research done by Ross and published in American Sociological Review 3 years ago pretty definitely establishes that. Now, the economic definition of class, if we do just look at that, right? I have here, this is from the United States Census Bureau and the Roper Organization working together. This is from last year. One thing, by the way, it's interesting here. When sociologists first began to study class, one of the things that we developed was what we called the reputational approach, or the self-reputation. That is, we'd ask people, what's your class? Right? Well, it turns out that if that method is used, 94% of American citizens define themselves as middle class. All right. only 1% will define themselves as upper class, and 5% will define themselves as lower class. So we obviously, as sociologists, use these other measures. All right. Well, economically, by the way, this is more or less general agreement. Now, the way I got this, I went to a lot of different introductory sociology books. I figured this is what people are taught at the intro level. This is must be what the editors and everyone else in the field sort of agree on. All right. Well, the upper class. It's generally, economically, generally thought of as about 1 to 3% of our population, and begins, the bottom line, at about $450,000 a year income. Yeah. Okay. Now, that is income. All right. I'm not talking about another dimension of class, which is wealth. All right. I'm going to stick more or less with income. Wealth, here's the good way to distinguish between the two, is income is when you work for money, and wealth is when money works for you. All right? So the Rockefellers, Vanderbilts, DuPonts, those people, money is working for them. All right? Now, 450,000 and up. The upper middle class, that is household income minimum of about $90,000 a year. Right. So when we say household, we mean that there could be, well, be more than one person contributing, you know, both adults in the household working. Minimum, 90,000 on up to the 400s. Now, obviously, the line's below. Right? The what's called the lower middle class, we go from what is considered the median income in the United States. Last year, that means half the people in this country made above, half below, $35,000 a year. So between 35,000 then up to about 90,000 would be considered the lower middle class. All right. The working class then is anywhere from 15,000 to 35,000. And the poor then 15,000 and below. As I said, the lines blur. For instance, there is this category of what's called the working poor. These people that are making perhaps $17,000 a year, income-wise, but they still find themselves stricken and in poverty. All right. Now, that's just by income alone. Now, obviously, the sociologist also associates this, as I said before, with occupational prestige. We're ranging then from, for instance, doctors, MDs. As of last year, the average income for a physician in the United States was in the realm of $160,000 a year. And that's, you know, pediatricians and GPs are at the bottom. Neurosurgeons, cardiac surgeons are up near the $400,000, $500,000 range. In terms of occupational prestige, by the way, people that follow right behind MDs are PhDs. Especially in the context of being university professors, scientists, people like that. All right. followed then by judges, architects, dentists, professionals, all right? At the middle range, interestingly enough, here we find business executives, CEOs, we find teachers, white-collar workers, small business owners. And at the bottom end, of course, we find the factory workers, the skilled technicians, and then at the poverty level, the migrant worker, you know, and those that are what called, quote, chronically unemployed. Now, whether we look at it by income or by the five variables, all right, what has happened in this country, basically, is that there has developed what I would call, what some call simply stagnation. Others call it stabilization. I'm of that school. I think our country has finally stabilized. All right. It's not a matter of stagnation. Now, but before I get into that, let me explain now social mobility from a sociologic point of view. And that's the terminology that's used in connection with stagnation versus stabilization. When we talk about social mobility, what we are talking about is vertical and horizontal. Now, vertical means that a person can go up or down in our class structure. Horizontal means a person stays within a class. Now, horizontal makes more sense when one thinks of that in terms of generations, families over time. Vertical, upward mobility is the individual, and that is, of course, the American dream. I had a professor at the University of Massachusetts who very proudly would tell me how his father, who had come from Ireland, was a factory worker in Holyoke, in what was called the Churchill section of Holyoke, very tough neighborhood area, mills and all of that. And John had worked his way through college at the University of Massachusetts, got a scholarship to Yale. While he was a graduate student at Yale in sociology, he married Smithy and finished his PhD and became a professor of sociology at UMass, all right, published books. And there he was. He represented the American dream, upward vertical social mobility. And he said it was education, all right, from going to college, going to graduate school, all right, getting hired, and there he was in the field of education. Now, sociologists have looked at the functions of upward mobility, and I want to address these just very briefly because it's part of the context here. This has been known as the Davis-Moore hypothesis, and what it says about upward mobility in America is this, is that first of all, people such as my professor John O'Rourke are role models for others to emulate. Say, see, that person did it, all right? William Julius Wilson did it. He's now at Harvard. All right, one of the most famous professors in the United States, all right, African-American black professor, all right. I was his teaching assistant and his friend, all right, where he started at UMass, all right. Now, secondly, and we could say this about John or Bill, that the system then that has education as the way, it draws the best, you see. The best can be drawn up. And that by saying, well, look how much they can end up making, the prestige, the respect they get, the lifestyle changes that happen, well, then we are also, thirdly, rewarding these people. The rewards are out there, all right, for this upward mobility. And lastly, it symbolizes what America is all about. I mean, immigrants to this country, right? I mean, it's the place one can go. It's where you can go and make money. It's where you can go and you know, leave behind the poverty of Europe or wherever it is that you... I had a student a number of years ago, he was from Iran. And you can never go back. Some of you might remember him, Esmail was his name. He had got a job working at a gas station while he was going to school here. He went out and bought 80 pair of shoes, and while he was pumping gas, he sold the shoes to people he was pumping the gas to. He came to me once, he said, Ken, this country is wonderful. He said, I could sell dirt. Right? He now owns 5 apartment buildings in the Hartford area. All right, and finished, he did go on and finish here, but I don't believe he ever finished his 4-year degree. All right, now, so what we have then, you see, is a system based upon achievement, as exemplified in any person can become president. All right, that's what this country is all about. As opposed to, I saw you scowl. I'm not saying that that's how it actually works. That's my point here. Right? That as opposed to the manner born, things based upon ascription. I mean, this country was indeed founded in part on the escape from ascription as what determines a person's class. All right. That is, the lords, the barons, the earls, the duchess, you know, all of that, no, all right? It's a country of achievement. Now, when we look historically, what we find is in the 17 and 1800s, this is essentially what our class system looked like. Right? Here's our upper class, right? We have a tiny middle class and a large, large lower class. Right? So, now, what happened to change this from a triangle, from a pyramid to the diamond, was the Industrial Revolution. All right, we had a basic structural change in this country. So all of a sudden, by the 1860s, 1900s, up through about right up until the 1970s, this is what we now have. Upper class, lower class, and a huge middle class. Huge. Now, most of the world, by the way, still looks like this. Most of the world. There are very few countries in this modern day and age that look like this. Japan, for instance, is one that looks like this. Some of the Scandinavian countries, but most, no. Tiny upper class, tiny middle class, and a large lower, or in the terminology of William Julius Wilson, underclass, all right, which people are moving away from because of certain implications of the term. All right. What really occurred, as I said, was structural change. That is, when you all of a sudden build factories, when you build railroads, when all manufacturing occurs, jobs appear. You need people to regulate workers. You need people to keep time for the railroads. You need people to build the trains. I mean, all of a sudden, just more and more work appeared in our society with more middle-range occupations. And then what happens? You need education. All right? You need people to go to school to be able to get into all of those managerial positions. All right? Now, that's essentially what occurred. All right, now, because we had complex organizations being created. In the words of Max Weber, talking about the nature of modern complex society and organizations, he talked about the necessity for impersonal decision making based upon technical expertise and skill. Now, therefore, where do you get that technical expertise and skill? For hiring, for promotions, for the rationalization, the decision makings that you would make as a company or whatever. You get it through education. Recognized intuitively in what, the 1860s was the Morrell Act that created the state university system throughout this country. All right, and now the biggest thing, of course, was World War II, people returning from the war, more and more people going to school, enormous industrial growth in this country. All right, but what happened was it stopped. Right. And when it stopped, when that growth stopped, that's when education, as a crucial method of upward mobility, stopped. The trends since the 1970s have been this. There are just fewer, as I said, slots, you know, positions. Think about it from this standpoint. Once we, and this is somewhat subtle, once we did away with age discrimination, all right, older people don't leave slots. So there are younger people that no matter how well educated they are, it doesn't matter. They're not going to get jobs. because the older people aren't leaving those jobs. They're staying. All right? Mandatory retirement doesn't happen. Now, also, so longer life, later retirement. Secondly, there are lots of new slots occurring. Lots. They're just not happening in the United States. That global economy, that where are, you know, I was in Bangkok a few years ago. Kodak is, and Fuji, you know, that's where they're building their companies now. All right. So, and what happens? Our management people go over to train people there to be management people. So the new slots are being, in other words, what we're seeing in some regard are other countries that are slowly moving from that to this as they industrialize. All right. Now, we obviously have the loss of slots in this country. It's politely referred to as right-sizing or downsizing, you know. All of that kind of thing is, that's been occurring, all right? Now, so there's been a general economic slowdown. Now, what has happened then is that what has occurred is, ever since the 1970s, increased occupational inheritance and therefore increased class inheritance. That is, people are taking on the occupations of their parents or staying within their class. Everything is now movement within. There is very little change anymore. This was in the New York Times in August of this year, in the entertainment section, in terms of Hollywood. Now, entertainment's one of those areas where we think, oh, anybody can go out, break into showbiz. New actors, Jace Alexander, mother Jane Alexander, Sean Austin, father John Austin, mother Patty Duke, Josh Brolin, James Brolin's a father, Jared Harris, Richard Harris is the father, Tony Goldwyn, Samuel Golden is the grandfather, Jennifer Grant, Cary Grant and Diane Cannon are the parents, Angelina Jolly, father is John Voight, Brawley Nolte, Nick Nolte is the father, Gwyneth Paltrow, very popular young woman these days. Her mother is Blythe Danner. Mira Sorvino, Paul Sorvino, Nicolas Cage, he changed his name, it's Coppola. All right. And Jamie Lee Curtis, Tony Curtis, and Lee. All right, and that, you know, it just is on and on. Think of the Barrymores, the Carradines, all of these dynasties. All right, so that's occupational inheritance. All right. Well, okay, let me get into education per se just a little more. When I said horizontal mobility, a recent study of medical schools in this country. Now, first of all, here's how the whole slot system works. The number of medical schools will limit automatically the number of doctors, right? Because only so many can be graduated per year. Right? So you have a limited number of slots that are out there, that's it. That will be created. Now, this was a survey done in terms of the parental background. 60% of students in medical school, one or more of their parents is an MD. 60%. Now we've got 40% left. 35%, now we're going to cover 95% of all students in medical school. The next 35%, their parents are members of other upper middle class occupations. University professors, architects, judges. Here's a good example. Right here in Greenfield, we have and I mentioned this to my classes. I said, I think there's a federal judge that lives here in Greenfield. And somebody said, yeah, Highland Avenue. They even know the street. And I said, and I think he has a son who's a doctor here in town. And then they go, oh yeah, Dr. Hare. There's occupational inheritance. He lives in a big house on High Street. All right. So there's your occupational inheritance, there's your class inheritance. All right? And that's the way it works. Now, we're left with 5% in medical school. 4% come from lower middle class backgrounds. Their parents are small business owners, high school, grade school teachers, people like that. 1% are there on scholarship. 1% are there attempting to work their way through under minority programs, or whatever. 1%. Right. So that's the amount of growth that can be expected, right, in terms of really of doing that, the John O'Rourke thing, all the way from the bottom to the top. Yeah. The 5% growth is where you would expect from the lower middle class. And I'll come back to that in a few minutes. Now, basically, in terms of education, most sociologists maintain, replicates the system as we have it now. All right. So here's some of my data. In the United States right now, there's approximately 3 million colleges and universities. That includes community colleges. It's about 15 million students enrolled. So there's your general figures. Let me get a little more specific. I want to relate social class to college attendance. The upper class, that 1 to 3% of our population, 98% of their children attend private colleges in this country. They attend, they go. Almost all graduate. The upper middle class, it's estimated over 95% attend. Estimated over 90% complete at least a bachelor's degree. The lower middle class, now we're down to 40% attend, 4 in 10. The working class, 3 in 10 attend. And in the lower class, 1 in 10 attend. We're not even talking about graduation rates. All right? Yeah. The working class, it's about 33% attend. And in the lower class, the bottom, it's about 12% attend. And that gets broken down even more specifically. Most colleges, except for community colleges, for instance, require a high school diploma. Right? Now, only half of people in the lower classes ever attain a high school diploma. So you're narrowing it even further as to who actually attends. Right? Now, let's look then specifically at community colleges. All right. National average, about 12% of community college students go on and complete a bachelor's degree. People that attend community colleges more than likely come from the working class background in terms of our class structure, and some from the lower middle. You know who those 12% tend to be? The ones from the lower middle. Right. Yeah. Only about 5% when we track over time, 5% of those community college students graduate from the bachelor's go on and get some sort of graduate degree. Since the 1970s, there's been a push toward more and more vocational education at the community college level. The reasoning for that is that it provides the best chance for upward economic mobility. The government is thinking again in defining class solely in terms of economics. You'll make more money. All right? Now, according to a number of different sources, community colleges and the rest of the system simply reinforce the existing class system. Now, what then, one author asks, is what then does the community college really do if so few people actually move up? I mean, what's going on? Well, I mean, besides giving less a lot of work, you know, what does it do in terms of our society? Well, in the field of controversial way to put it. In the field of doing a con game, studies have shown that one of the most successful ways of conning somebody out of money is to have at least two con artists. The one that actually steals or rips you off, and a second person that you're unaware is associated with that first person, who comes along and talks to you and calms you down and gets you to accept your losses. All right? Just say, oh, don't go to the police. Oh, gosh, you know, same kind of things happen to me. That's called cooling out the mark. All right? The mark is the victim. That's cooling out the mark. All right? If you have a society that says education is for everybody, education is not a privilege anymore, education is a right, then the community colleges cool out the mark, don't they? It says, you can try, you can come here, you can see, now see you gave it a shot, or don't complain, why don't you just go over there, take a course or two, you see? So the people still continue to believe in education, in American society, and accept their losses, that they are locked into this class system, that education, as they might have been taught, will get them out, isn't getting them out. All right. That's one example. Now, what are some of the other ways, by the way, that people do move up the class system in the United States? Marriage. This one always gets me in trouble. I'm sorry, it exists. Now, what's intriguing here is it's out there, it works, all right? In the upper class, historically, it's really interesting, the double standard was that the men married up. Lower upper class men had to marry, the only way they could gain real status and respect was to marry the old rich young women, daughters. In recent years, Jack Kennedy, lower upper class, new rich, married the number one debutante of the year. You know, when they have these big debutantes that come out, you know, Jackie. All right, she came from old rich family. It was the only way he could gain some prestige and some status. He married up. For the rest of us in our society, it's a double standard that works another way. Generally, it's that the men, all right, marry within their class, all right, or they marry from someone below. That is, women have the opportunity through marriage to gain social class standing. The woman that can marry the attorney, right? The secretary who marries her boss, then assumes his class position. Common practice. The problem is that as our divorce rate has gone up, right, these people then immediately plunge back. We had a book that came out in the mid-80s by Lenore Weitzman, which attempted to describe what happens to women as a result of divorce, that they lose an enormous amount of income and really fall. Her statistics apparently are way off. It was more of an ideological work than an actual piece of data. But the researchers that replicated her research do agree that women do take a loss. Now, think of it this way, to counter about education. If the other person, if that woman were an attorney, she wouldn't lose her status, would she? She'd still have her occupational prestige. So there's it can be counterproductive, using marriage as a way to go up. You see? Yeah. But it exists. Now, thirdly, there is what I call politics. This is nepotism. This is favoritism. This is pulling strings. This is who you know. All right? Now, we don't think too much of that. We don't. See, the interesting thing is, ideologically in our society, it's education, it's hard work, that's the way you do it. These other methods are all sort of deviant, aren't they? You know, you're supposed to marry up, all right? You know, you aren't supposed to pull strings and get a good job. That's not the way to do it, all right? Thirdly, we also have the role of luck, and we make fun of that. We don't think a whole lot of luck either. What I'm talking about here is about there once was this guy named Jed, poor mountaineer, barely kept his family fed. He's out hunting for some food, and up to the ground came bubbling crude, and he moved to California, and we all laughed at him every week on TV because he had no idea of what it meant to be upper class. All he had was the money. And then we had another show that, interestingly enough, did just the opposite, Green Acres. The people that had the class, but they didn't fit in either because they had too much education. They had too much whatever. All right. Now, luck. Fourth, free market skills and hard work. Now, that is something that gets paraded around and does work very well in our society. For a very few, but it works, doesn't it? Bill Gates is a perfect example of free market skills and hard work in modern America. We have Again, we have the example, by the way, in sports, all right? We have sports, for example, would be where one can market one's skills and where you work hard. Marv Levy is the coach of the Buffalo Bills professional football team. According to him, just this August in an interview, 1 in 10,000 athletes has a shot at a pro career in football, of making that, quote, money. The average length, by the way, of time in professional football is 4.5 years before injury or someone comes along who's better than you takes over. And you know, it's very clever. You know, at the bottom of the screen, it always tells you what college they went to? Only 28% are college graduates. So you're talking then about an overwhelming number of these men finishing out their 4.5 years with no educational background in terms of completion of formal, you know, the calf skin and all of that. Right. And so they're all of a sudden downward mobility for them too, just like the people that marry up, downward mobility. Okay, now we get to the law as a means of upward mobility. Probably the most famous case in recent years, of course, is civil rights legislation and specifically affirmative action. Affirmative action, according to Bill Wilson, is essentially a middle class program. And what it has done is it increased the size of middle class black America because it's become an issue of generational or family mobility, right? Middle class people send their kids to college. That's what's happened. Once the growth stopped in the 70s, all right, occupational inheritance, those middle class people sent their kids to school. So yes, the black middle class is growing in this country, but it is not growing because of new membership from lower classes. It is growing just in size from itself. By placing a demand, for instance, on hiring a black professor, or an Asian, or an Hispanic, all right, you're dealing with the end of the system. You're dealing with the person already having the credentials. You aren't dealing with the 4 or 5 year old kids that need the schooling. You're saying, right now, I gotta have that person with that doctorate. Well, where are they gonna come from? They're gonna come from families where they are sending their, where they value education, where they're sending them to school, right? That the modern civil rights movement of demand on campus, to me, isn't the answer. The answer is, you want to change things, go down to Springfield, go to Roxbury, start schools for the little kids. And then in 20 years, when you say, you got them, rather than reinforcing the existing middle class. The original intention of Johnson, Foreman, when they coined the term affirmative action, right, was for the lower classes, not for the middle classes. Right? Now, and that's how that, the, now, at the bottom line, here is the real issue, though. Here is the absolute real issue. We get a lot of resentment about affirmative action. We get people tired and get this job and blah, blah, blah. You know, think about it. The real issue is job scarcity. If there were plenty of jobs, there's your answer. Who would be fighting? All right? That's the problem. Our economic structure does not provide enough jobs for people. All right? So we've got this valuable resource, jobs. Right? And that, and not having enough jobs has all sorts of implications. In the 50s and the 60s, black and white people, Hispanics, worked alongside each other. They don't anymore. Fewer and fewer do. That contact, positive interaction, does more to destroy prejudice than any other single phenomena in our society. And by creating job segregation, now we've got neighborhoods. So there's neighborhoods outside Atlanta where white people can't live. You don't make enough money, none of us probably do, but you're also, most of you, the wrong color. Now that does not increase understanding and what this country is about. Lastly, as another avenue of upward mobility, let's not overlook crime. All right? I always remember in the book Godfather, and they used the same line in the movie. The son of the Godfather, trying to calm his wife down, said, "Dear, don't worry. In 10 more years, we'll be legitimate." All right? We'll put our money into banks. We'll open up banks. All right. Now, crime works. It's the American way of life. Daniel Bell has an article entitled, Crime is an American Way. He talks about, we go back historically, we have the privateers. We follow that up into the what we call the robber barons, and into recent times, organized crime. Right? I mean, it has worked. It has worked successfully. The 80s, we saw Wall Street lawyers, we saw the normalization of greed and envy in this country in the 80s, right? Now, okay, all those are the other avenues. Education, I guess an educated criminal is a better one, right? Lastly, let me just observe some implications in terms of the business structure in our society. If indeed we need impersonal decision making based on expertise and skill, then these other avenues, all right, ranging from luck and who you know and simply getting a job through marriage or other forms of manipulation, they're going to lead to a deterioration in quality of the business world, aren't they? And that's one of the arguments that's used, for instance, about affirmative action as well. One caveat there. If our system is supposed to draw the best upward, then when you deny an entire class of people simply on the basis of their sex, their age, their ability, their color, all right, access to the system, how are you drawing the best upward? You see? That denial of opportunity, I mean, there's a lot of, in other words, there are women, all right, there are people of various ages, physical abilities, that are pretty damn good at stuff. But when you automatically exclude them, how is this system of drawing the best upward working? You see? So that's a real caveat in terms of deterioration. In fact, just the opposite ought to be occurring, shouldn't it? You've increased your pool of talent, in other words, to draw from, to draw the best upward. So I'm not so sure. I think that lastly, what is happening in this country is we're seeing an increase in business universities. They're doing it themselves. They're not relying on us, all right? What do they call corporate universities? McDonald, isn't there a place called McDonald University? Right. Now, I think that overall, in the business world, we're finding money is becoming more and more the basic reinforcer for all decisions. Implications in terms of education, I think there'll be a growing reduction in the number of schools in this country. I mean, I look around, Northampton Business College is gone, Wyndham College is gone. I see, fewer and fewer colleges. There was a state college in Boston, gone. I think that education will return more and more to the elite as it simply is a matter of replacing people within the classes, all right? I think that there will be more and more emphasis upon vocational training. All right. In that context, for instance, LPNs replace RNs, physician's assistants replace physicians. I go to the doctor now, and it's an LPN and a physician's assistant that does everything. At the end, for 5 minutes, in comes the doctor. Now, I know LPNs don't get paid as much as RNs, and physician's assistants certainly don't get paid as much as physicians. And now they have surgical technicians, and there's a whole, paraprofessional training is going on. Lastly, I also think that in general, the student population will decline. As our economy picks up, why go to college? Especially if you are defining class economically as just how much money you make. I have students come in to me every day, not every day, it's an exaggeration, and say, what am I going to major in? Tell me something that makes a lot of money. That's all they're interested in. All right. And I come back with, gee, there's a lot more to life than just money. I mean, education, no, money. Lastly, okay, some implications for our society overall. I think we'll see increasing conflict or dissatisfaction or malaise. I think the gap between our classes is going to grow stronger in this country. Middle management is getting phased out. Right? We have upper management and we have workers. All right. I see that there'll be an increased classism in this country. There'll be I think, more and more resentment and envy on the part of lower class people toward people that are better off. All right? And this, more problems in this country. In the field of race relations, there's what's called an index of perceived differences. And what it relates to is that the more we perceive people like us, to be like us, the more kind, the more gentle, the more understanding. The more we perceive people as different from us, the more we misunderstand them, the more we tend to dislike them, those kinds of things. Well, when everyone gets educated on that level, we see people alike. We see people like us. That index of perceived differences goes down. But as the classes separate more along this line of elite getting educated only, up goes that index of perceived differences. All right? And hostility will follow. That there'll be a leveling off of the educated public, that training and technological graduation will become a goal in and of itself, paraprofessionals, as I said. That there'll be a furthering devaluation of higher education, since it can't necessarily increase one social class. That as higher education becomes seen more a means of class reinforcement, that is horizontal mobility, there will be more hostility in those not able to get it or who are denied the opportunity to get it. That the educational elite will continue to run this country over the, quote, dumb, confused, and uninformed, unquote. That there will be a continued victimization of those through the disappearance of work. And that lastly, economic motivation will increase in all areas of our life. In conclusion, I'm going to make a value judgment here. And this is a few sentences that I've written. Education, and by that I mean expertise, knowledge, and skills, must regain prominence as the baseline determinant in the hiring and promotions, as well as a valued quality of a person, along with the notion of free market skills and hard work. The economic structure must provide ample job opportunities for all. Class must not be defined solely as a monetary, that is, an economic competitive dynamic, since such a definition shifts focus away from, one, the informed citizen, two, the rational choice model of living, three, lifestyle and life chance enhancement effects of education, and lastly, the notion of cooperative and non-greed and envy order of living. All right. Went a little longer than I thought. I have a 1 o'clock class, but any questions? Any quick, Stephen?
Yeah. So I got it that you said at this point that, you know, it sounds like class is becoming fixed.
It's stabilized. Yeah.
All right. Yeah. So it'd be interesting to see if that changes. But also, I'm thinking that over the years, the number of people getting advanced degrees has grown in the country, more MAs, more PhDs. Has that trend since those sounds like those advanced degrees aren't giving people jobs equivalent to those degrees because there aren't slots, and right, as you mentioned. Does that mean, I don't know whether it's changed or you think it will change toward a decrease in people getting, you know, will those numbers decrease in people getting advanced degrees because they're not doing any good?
Well, the replication of classes where the advanced degrees take place, add on connections, who you know will get you hired. That already, people from Yale hire people from Yale, next generation or whatever. That, yeah, in and of itself, just getting the degree doesn't work. You know, when I was in grad school, I was told that for every sociologist graduating, there were six jobs out there. Now, it's just the opposite. There's six sociologists for every job. So now, if I were coming out of school, I'd have to rely on who I knew, who I married, crime. I mean, I'd have to burn down, whatever. I'd have to rely on all sorts of other things to even get a job. So it's not so safe. It's not just education anymore.
Even a PhD isn't a guarantee.
Not at all. It used to be. I mean, I got a job in the 60s. I was the only person that here. I was the only person that applied.
That's strange.
Yeah, back then it's the way it was. George?
Yeah, I was thinking one thing in regard to the last remark. There's been an upgrading of the standard of expectations of what an educated person is. And that has been upgraded. I mean, there was a time when a very sparse part of our population would expect to go to college at all.
Which was the elite, right?
It was expected
to go. Well, that's what I'm saying. It's returning to that, George.
There's another aspect of education, the historical aspect, and that was the function of education, keeping people out of the job market.
For a short period of time. Yeah. Ah, that's a good point. It's a good point. Anne?
I was curious about, you made some connections to the turn of the century 100 years ago of the Industrial Revolution, and what do you see with the technological revolution and service industry shifts that are occurring at this point in time, and the connections of higher education?
Well, I think that, for one thing, I don't think you have to be as educated as you used to perform some of the same technological functions. 5 years ago, to program a VCR, compared to today, they dumbed it down, so to speak. We've moved into the service economy, right? Is that what you mean? Service and technology? In the manufacturing sector, we have Germany do it, we have Japan do it for us. I don't really know what's going to happen. Now Mexico is supposedly stealing the industrial jobs. What do you perceive? I don't know what the future holds.
It seems at some point there's going to be a need for more education, but I think you're right in terms of the leveling off that we're seeing right now. But it seems like 20, 25, 30 years down the line, that to operate in a technologically advanced society, it may need more education.
See, that's what I'm not so sure of, because we've been able to get rid of middle management. The computers can make those decisions, and then it's easier to run a computer than it ever was before.
Yes.
So that's what I meant by we've dumbed down the machines. Which furthers the debt. Well, thank you very much.